can see clearly now, the rain is gone.
When that record came out a few years ago, and when a guy named Bob Marley and the Wailers came along, and a movie called The Harder They Come, we all began hearing about a new kind of music, R-E-G-G-A-E, reggae music, and about the curious cult in Jamaica from which it sprang. Well, as we shall show you, there is reason to believe we are soon going to be hearing a lot more of reggae. A vacant lot under a tree in Kingston, Jamaica. A religious ceremony is held. Bible verse with a beat. But in this religion, the promised land is thought to be Ethiopia. The Messiah, Haile Selassie, self-proclaimed Lion of Judah. So in this cult, to resemble lions, men wear braids, which they call dreadlocks. They smoke ganja, high-test marijuana, which they say is holy weed. The smoke is part of the religion. The religion and the beat rise from the smoke. Before he became emperor, Haile Selassie was called Rastafari, so these men call themselves Rastafarians. And the beat, their beat, has become the pulse of reggae music.
War in a Babylon, tribal war in a Babylon.
Reggae is the slick, amplified commercialization of the Rasta beat. And listen to the words.
War in a Babylon.
War in Babylon.
Tribal war in Babylon.
Tribal war in Babylon. Babylon is the Rasta word for the establishment. And the song says the war against the establishment has begun. Oh, make no mistake, the Rastafarian religion and reggae music are both flat-out revolutionary. Revolution must come, they say. Revolution has come, they say. The policemen no like the dreadlocks man. The dreadlocks man no like the policemen. There are maybe 70,000 dreadlocks men, Rastafarians. It is their cry of revolution, but it is also the biggest musical sound in all of Jamaica. The singer is Max Romeo, a Rasta man, a dreadlocks man under that cap. And the air in the studio at the moment is Rasta air. They've made as much smoke as music this session. Place is owned by Scratch, and he has a couple of special visitors down from New York today. Men bent on taking reggae music more than ever to America. They probably can do it. He is Michael Butler.
Oi! Oi! Winston! You ready? Ready, man!
Ready? Go there!
Michael Butler is the producer who 9 years ago startled and influenced American show business by bringing the musical Hair to Broadway. Now he wants to startle again with reggae. Butler is mounting a full-scale $850,000 Broadway show of reggae music, and Max Romeo will be in it.
Welcome to the art, Michael.
Well, nice to be here.
Nice to have you.
Really nice sound. How about coming up to New York on Monday?
Opening this fall, Butler hopes to make a splash with reggae that all of us, those vaguely familiar with it already, those who don't know how to spell it, will feel.
Well, I really liked it, Max. I think it gives a feeling of movement. I really wanted to move.
Yes, it's a confusion as to how you move to reggae. So it's going to be something that's really easy.
Yeah, that's where it will fit in, you know.
To see us dance reggae where you feel it.
Great sound, God.
This singer is called Dillinger, and the joint, would you believe, is called the Garden of Eden. And in Jamaica, it's an ivory night. In the patois of the slums, that means Saturday night and time to get down with some reggae. Reggae means something to them. Will it ever to us? The social revolution among poor Jamaican blacks, which reggae sings about, is virtually unknown in America. The Garden of Eden is a very long way from Kansas, Toto. Can reggae make the journey? Well, reggae was carried by Jamaicans to London, has been adopted by Britons, is one of the biggest sounds in England today. So the question is, can it make it from the Garden of Eden to the Big Apple? Which, granted, is still a long way from Kansas, Toto, but Kansas listens to Broadway. The production team for the musical gathers in a New York rehearsal hall. The director, Leon Gluckman.
So it's a Trenchtown song. It's got humor in it. It paints the picture in it. There are two scenes in which it's a...
Producer Butler, star Max Romeo, choreographer Margot Sappington.
You know what I'd like, if we've got time for this now while we're talking? Like you particularly to see, Margot, some of the movements, the actual dance movements. I mean, it's source material, choreographic source material, which is really good.
Does it have a sequence to it, a pattern? Like you do a certain amount of things a certain number of times?
No, it's kind of freestyle.
Right.
It's our mobile type of dance. Keep playing, you know?
What's the beat behind that? Huh? What's the Junkanoo rhythm? Let's do some of that.
That song, there are a series of characters. It'd be terrific if we can actually find a place for it. So, Margot, what do you think, Michael? Have you had enough? I mean, we know what the talking
exactly.
thing is.
Huh? Yeah. Exactly.
Okay, because while we're all together, I really do want everybody to hear the new arrangement of Promised Land. Is that okay, Michael?
Yeah, we're ready.
All right. So let's have it now.
Good. This will probably be the title song of the musical. Promised Land. The singer is Ross Kirby.
Trying to find my way to the promised land. Will you take my hand?
Try to find my way to the promised land. But in this story, as in life, different people have different ideas what the promised land is. For poor blacks in Jamaica, for people feeling oppressed, wanting pride, seeking identity, for them, a place in the world where a black man could come to power as an emperor, Lion of Judah, such a place, Ethiopia, may be the promised land. But in New York, where they're making a show, costume designer Raoul Panay Dubois, who dressed the show's No No Nanette and Wonderful Town, tries now to capture the look of ghetto Jamaica, of Dreadlocks Man. Set designer Peter Larkin, who created the mythical land Peter Pan once flew through, now draws Trenchtown. For those who make theater, the promised land is Broadway.
Ago, Americans were scorning hippies and judging people by the way they wore their hair. And then Michael Butler brought the musical hair to Broadway, and 2 years after that, you could get in an elevator, and on the Muzak, you would hear The Age of Aquarius and watch businessmen smiling, even if they didn't know what it meant.
Exactly, and that's why maybe 2 years from now, businessmen are going to be swinging to revolutionary reggae and not knowing what it means.